future, this other method is, it's gotta be before that. So in section 10.5, we'll learn the first method, and then the only method, that doesn't involve getting zero on the other side, okay, called completing the square. So I'm lying a little bit when I say we always need a zero on the other side. There's this thing in 10.5 that says there's this other method where we don't want a zero on the other side. It's a whole different approach. Okay. But for now, what we want to do is get zero on one side. Well, how do I do that? Subtract 1. But I cannot subtract 1 inside, I can't just like, well, 4 minus 1 is 3, because it's inside the parentheses that needs to first have multiplication happen to it. Right? You've got to distribute before you do the subtraction. I need to multiply this by 4 before I start subtracting 1 from anything. So we'll just write this. And once I've taken care of the multiplication, then I can subtract 1 from any like terms that I find after that distribution. So we distribute the 4. We come out with 12y squared minus 28y plus 16 minus 1. I can't subtract 1 from this, obviously, or that. The natural thing to subtract 1 from is the 16. So I get 12y squared minus 28y plus 15. And after doing all that, now I can start to try and factor it to solve the equation. First things first, let's see how this is going to work. We're going to look at it, see if there's any factors we can take out of all of these. Let's see, a 5, is a factor of 5? No, these don't have factors of 5.
3.
3, that does, this doesn't. That doesn't have a factor of 3. This only has 5 and 3 and 15, so I can end my search now. I don't even need to worry about the 7 here, because 7 wasn't a factor of this one. So. Well, we're just done with that idea. It's not like you can factor out something from all of them, but that's always something we check for. That would make our life a lot easier. So here we go. We prepare to do the AC method. And as laborious and difficult as this is going to be, it's a lot easier than just guessing and checking what the factors would be. So much faster. So first you take A times C, that's why I call it the AC method. 12 times 15 is 380. And down here we have negative 28, that's B. And so we figure out what two numbers multiply together to be a positive 180 and add together to be a negative 28. All right, that much information already tells me that they have to be two negative numbers. Two negatives multiply to make a positive, and they add together to make a negative. So far, rolling right along. Now I gotta think what multiplies to 180 and now adds together to be 28. Try 2 and 90. That's not going to work. Right? That's not good. Then it multiplies to negative 180, or sorry, positive 180, but it doesn't add to negative 28. So forget that. Let's try, what's that?
3 and 60.
3 and 60. Good. 3 and 60 multiplies to 180, but they add to negative 63, not negative 28.
Negative 18 and 10.
Negative 18 and negative 10. That factorization is pretty easy to see because there's a 0 at the end, right? So we know it's divisible by 10. Negative 18 times negative 10 is 180, and negative 18 minus 10 is negative 28. So we found it. We found the very helpful combination, negative 10, negative 18. Right. What we do with those is we separate negative 28y into 18y, negative 18y, and negative 10y. Very handy numbers to know. Group them. I like using highlighter to so they don't get confused by any mathematical symbol. see this group in yellow, and I ask myself about the group in yellow, what am I trying to figure out with this group in yellow? What do they both have in common that we can take away? What mistake did I already make that I'm noticing and I'm about to fix?
Put a square in the bottom.
Gotta put a square. Right. Okay. Now I fixed it. So what do these two have in common?
3 and 1.
3y. Leaves us with 4y minus 6. Double checking. 3y times 4y is 12y squared. 3y times negative 6. 3 times negative 6 is negative 18. There's y there. Negative 18y. And then look at these two and ask ourselves, what do these two have in common? Well, I would say make it negative because the first thing here is negative. What's that?
Negative 5.
Let's see, negative 5 times a positive should be a 2y. We can pull out more than a 6. Or more than a, what would we pull out, a 3? We can pull out a 6.
Yes, we can.
I factored out a 3y. We should have factored out a 6y. That's why this wasn't working out. 6y, so that's a 2y minus 3. So the group 2y, negative 5 times 2y is negative 10y. Negative 5 times negative 3, negative 5 times negative 3 is 15. We are almost to a point where it matters that it's equal to 0. So far, all we've been doing is factoring. Just factoring and factoring to the left side. Now we see we have a common factor of 2y minus 3. In both of these, we factor out the 2y minus 3. We're left with 6y minus 5. 0. We set each factor equal to 0. Add 3 to both sides. 2y equals 3. Divide by 2y equals 3 halves. Set this factor equal to 0. 6y minus 5 equals 0. Add 5. 6y equals 5. Divide by 6. Y equals 5 sixths. Kind of a long journey, but we got there. Gotta make sure we have 0 on one side, which means we have to multiply the 4 throughout, and distribute the 4, and then subtract 1 from both sides. Got us to this guy here, 15 on the end. And then we use that AC method, and we got negative 18, negative 10, factored out from both groups, factored out the common factor of 2y minus 3, and set each factor equal to 0, solved both of those equations. Found our two solutions, 3 halves and 5 sixths. Another one was 42. So you give us a function, g of x is equal to 2x squared. Plus x minus 1. The instructions say find the zeros. That means figure out what you can plug in for x so that the output is 0. Figure out the x that you plug in is 0. Well, that just means I can set up this equation. Right? I'm trying to figure out what x can go in here so that the output is 0. So make the output 0, and I work my way backwards, try to figure out what the x would have to be. So just solve this equation, quadratic equals 0, like we've done plenty of times. Now this quadratic here, almost easier to do, just to guess and check. You can tell when it's going to be a little easier to use guess and check, because that does not factor all that many ways, and neither does negative 1. So now comes the benefit of all that experience. We can tell when we should use that AC method that we used in the previous problem, and when we might just go ahead and try the guessing and checking, because I can tell this is going to factor as two things. It's got to be a 2x times x to give me 2x squared. Now I just kind of have to experiment and see this number times this number needs to be negative 1. There's not all that many. be lucky to guess it the first time, that's right. Negative one here, a positive one there. Gotta be a negative one times a one. And if it works out to a positive x in the middle, then I found it. So if I multiply out, I get 2x squared. 2x times 1 is 2x. Negative 1 times x is negative x. Negative 1 times 1 is negative 1. 2x minus x is x. So I did just happen to guess right and get the correct factorization. Let me set each factor equal to 0. And add 1 to both sides, divide by 2 on both sides, well, x is 1 half. Subtract 1 from both sides, x is negative 1. Sometimes that can take a few minutes to figure out, like the previous example. You could have tried a lot of different factors of 180 before you figured out the 2 that add negative 28. Once you found it, should be smooth sailing. Any questions about this one, previous one, other homework problem? General questions? If not, then let's, you got a piece of paper? And forward. You got a piece of paper ready for review. All right, so I am going to use the approach that I've been teaching you, just so you can see more practice of it. If you manage to guess your way through it, that's great, and I wish you the best. But yeah, on average, it's not going to work the fastest each time. Because this 35 for 1 is negative, and there's not a lot of factorizations that work, but I don't know. There's still some guessing and checking, and like I said, let's get some practice. So. We have a times c, that's 2 times negative 35, that's negative 70. Put our negative 3 here. Figure out what multiplies the negative 70 and adds the negative 3. First of all, we know it's a positive and a negative. Either way, we multiply to get a negative. 7 and negative 10. 7 times negative 10 is 70. 7 minus 10 is negative 3. So, all right. Again, I'm still seeing this mistake. These do not tell us. Like the second half of the factors does not tell us what to put into the parentheses, right? It's just telling us how to split up the negative 3x. We're going to write it now as plus 7x minus 10x, or minus 10x plus 7x. It'll look different, but in the end, we'll get the same answers. Remember that. You might want to take some notes to that effect if you are making that mistake. Still at this point. Really good idea. Notes are good. Notes are not bad for you. I don't know why we don't take more. So now we look at it as two different groups. First, I'm going to have to make this darker because the highlighters are going to wash it out. That's where I screwed up. 2x. Second group, and we set off to work. What do these two have in common? 2x squared and 7x. X, and that's it, right? 2 and 7 don't have any common factors, so that's a done deal. X times 2x plus 7. And these two?
5.
5, but since there's a negative in front, make it a negative 5. So we'll pull out a negative 5. 5 times, it's going to leave us with a 2x. Negative 5 times 2x is negative 10x. Negative 5 times 7, positive 7, is negative 35. Okay. Being able to do this told us we were going to be able to factor it. These two being identical tells us we did all of that work correctly. If they're not identical, check your work, because something went wrong. Maybe you forgot to factor out a negative. You just factored a positive 5. Or maybe the number you factored out over here could have been bigger, like in the previous example. But once we're here and these factors are identical, or they have this factor in common, we'll factor out that factor. We're left with x minus 5 equals 0. No more room. set each factor equal to 0. And solve for x, subtract 7, divide by 2, we get a negative 7 halves. Add 5. Feel like checking that out, try negative 7 halves in for x, 2 times -7 halves squared minus 2 times -7 halves minus 35, it's about to be 0. Kind of amazing that we use that approach to find the two solutions to this equation. So we have more factoring. Bad news, more factoring. Good news, more factoring. Because we get a chance to practice something that if we feel like we're not completely great at it yet, we have more time to practice it. It's not like we're moving on to something crazy new, right? And feeling like we're getting left behind. I'm trying to do lots of time to work on this because I'm kind of picking and choosing what I want to add on from this section. And lot. But let's say we were to take, it doesn't matter, I don't know, let's take like 5x minus 8 and 5x plus 8. Not the first time we've done something like this. Actually, it's not the first time we've done, we may have done this exact thing. Anybody want to walk us through it? I mean, we should pretty experienced there was one. The last one was very much like this. And it's going to show us, as we're factoring, here's one peculiar pattern of factoring that may look like you can't really do it. You might be feeling a little lost, but if it fits a particular pattern, you know it's got a factor. Basically, it's got a factor like this is factored. This is factored. We'll see what it looks like when it's unfactored, multiplied together. We'll recognize that pattern and say, there are some patterns, or there's actually one in particular, that I know factors like this. Okay, it's a special kind of a pattern. We'll see what it's called when we multiply these together. Who wants to walk us through multiplying these together?
So you like, kind of distribute it. Like we used to do, like we kind of
double distribution.
Yeah, double distribution.
Okay, so you're going to
be like 20.
Oh, wait. You're going to do what?
Well, I kind of want to know what the first half is, just 25 and x squared.
We know that there will be a 5x getting multiplied by a 5x somewhere in that double distribution process, right? Mm-hmm. So we know that. What else?
And then it's just like what you usually do. So then you like take negative 8 and then distribute it to.
Distribute it. So we're going to get negative 40x when we distribute to negative 8. And positive 8 is negative 64. But then we just missed one thing. We missed 5x times positive 8, which is positive 40x.
So then they just be combined like terms after that.
Yeah, what are these like terms combined to?
0 and 0.
Okay, so we get this cancellation. These two guys cancel out. Not surprising. These are so close to being the same thing, except for one of them has a negative 8, one of them has a positive 8. It wouldn't be surprising that I'm going to wind up with a positive something and a negative, probably exactly the same thing, but negative, like the exact opposite thing. When they add together, they get to 0. If they were exactly identical, something else would happen. Well, this would be a positive 40x and a positive 40x, and now instead of canceling each other, it would be like double itself. 40 plus 40 would be 8. But when they're opposite like that, we get the middle thing canceling out. So if I just said, hey, you factor this, feel like you're not sure what to do, though, you can definitely use the AC method. The only way for that middle thing to cancel out is if it factors like that, okay? And like that, meaning, check out that 5, right? 5 and this 25 are related, and that 5 is the what? Times the what? 25.
Square root.
Square root. About 8 is the square root of 64, right? So if this is a square and we're subtracting another square, call that difference of squares. And it factors just like that. We already had difference of squares, if you remember. It's just that our difference of squares didn't have anything in front here, just like x squared minus 4, x squared minus 64, x squared minus 16. So we used this difference of squares pattern before, just not with anything in front of x squared, just the 1 in front of x squared in that case. So we can see how 25x squared minus 64 factors as 5x minus 8 and 5x plus 8. So if I gave you 16x squared minus 25, noticing, it's like my brain's picking up on, oh, look at 16, that's a square number. X squared is obviously a square. 25 is a square number. So that's a difference of squares. It's got a difference, a subtraction. Both of the terms are squares. So I know it should factor as 4x plus 5 and 4x minus 5. So you multiply together and see how they kind of match up. I've shown you how this should factor. Let's see what you do if I give you another one that should factor as well. Like 9x squared minus 49. 9x squared minus 49. Using our experience from the previous two problems, what do we think? How would this factor? 3x
minus
7.
Plus 7.
Did you multiply them together, or even just like mentally to see if it checks out?
Yeah.
Do it real quick, right? 3x times 3x and 3x times 7. I think it could be the first part. 3, 9. 3x times 3x is 9x squared. 3x times 7, 21x. Negative 7 times 3, negative 21x. Negative 7 times 7, negative. These are canceled out, 9x squared minus 49. Yeah, checks out. The reason I'm erasing that is to show you. That was just to check and make sure that we factored it correctly. 9x squared minus 49. Factors is 3x minus 7, 3x plus 7. So, you know, what I've done there is just show you a couple of examples of how to use this new tool, this new pattern. Take that and you put it in the old math tackle box. Keep it in mind when you're factoring. You know, like, tried all the things that I know. Maybe that difference of squares thing, maybe that would work. Maybe try factoring it as square root minus the square root times square root plus the square root. Let's look at this one real quick. 25x squared plus 9. 25x squared plus 9. I got a plus there, right? Not a minus. Well, 25x squared plus 9, I've written down basically like the only three things I might think would work, since there's no middle term. I'm taking like it's this difference of squares thing, but it's not a difference of squares, it's the sum of two squares, because we're adding one. So, I'm thinking probably not this, because I know that would come out to be 25x squared minus 9. Okay. So, that's out. That didn't work. Then I think, okay, well, maybe they should both be positive. But then I get 25x squared plus 15x plus another 15x plus 9, which is 25x squared plus 30x plus 9. No canceling there. Then I get things like, okay, well, to get canceling, I'd have to have a negative. Maybe they're both negative. But then I find out it's 25x squared minus 15x minus another 15x plus 9. So I get the plus 9s here and here, but One way I get plus 30x, this way I get minus 30x. Plus 9. What do you think?
I just miss the it. Positive and the negative around. Oh, wait, no, I want to change anything, would it? No, wait. My bad.
I'm not sure. I didn't fully understand what you asked, but it sounds like you answered it yourself.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you think? As I try to factor this, is there a conclusion I can draw?
It's impossible.
It's impossible. It's unfactorable. So we call in the polynomial world irreducible or prime. This quadratic here is prime just like 7's prime. There's no way to factor down 7 into two simpler factors, and there's no way to factor out 25x squared plus 9. So don't be fooled. 25x squared plus 9 is not factorable, where 25x squared minus 9 is factorable. You can see it's factorable as 5x plus 3, 5x minus 3. So if I put that together with everything else I know about factoring, I can solve equations where there's a difference of squares. I can find the zeros of functions where there's a difference of squares, or another pattern. And this last one that I wouldn't even bother memorizing, but there's an interesting little pattern that happens. Let's say we had 9x squared plus 98x plus 121. That's silly. It's too big.
Yeah.
Let's just calm down, everybody. Let's just say 72x plus. Look at this, and it doesn't look all that special. It doesn't look any different than any other factoring I've done. Does it? Maybe it does to you, but to me I see it and it's just like, I don't know. It just looks kind of normal. But it turns out when we factor it, it will have an interesting result. But then memorizing this pattern is not really worth the time it takes to memorize it. So what I'll do, I'll just approach it like I would any other. Okay? So 9 times 16. Would 9 work? 9 times something is 144.
Change it to 25.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
I know, I shouldn't have. I admit that. Okay. Two numbers that multiply to 144 and add to 24.
12 and 12.
There's the first interesting thing that we haven't really seen happen before. Those two numbers are the same number. Right? Probably something unique will happen here. 9x squared plus 12x plus 12x. Plus 16. 12 and 12, 12x and 24x. So I look at this group and I say 3x come out of those. Left with 3x plus 4. And from these two,
4
leaves me with 3x plus 4. So I back out the 3x plus 4 for both of these. three x plus four. So I'm left with three x plus four. So what's unique about this that we've not seen before?
They both the same.
Does anything? Three x plus four and another three x plus four. This factor that we factored out is 3x plus 4, and the leftovers are 3x plus 4. So, that hasn't happened before. You could write it as 3x plus 4 squared, because it's a thing that's multiplied by itself. That thing is 3x plus 4. The book might tell you that, okay, so what you need to recognize is that this is a square number. The square root is 3. The square root of this is 4. And this, it's not 3 times 4, but it's twice that. Right? It's 3 times 4 times 2.
So 3 times 8?
Well,
6 times 4. Right.
So the square root of this is 3, the square root of this is 4. If you multiply 3 by 4, you get 12.
Right.
If you double that, you should get this.
Yeah.
That's the rule. That's the pattern. If this, if this has a square root and this has a square root, if you multiply the square roots together and double it and get this guy, well, there's a pattern.
Mm-hmm.
It tells me that it is the square root of the first plus the square root of the second times that. Again, square root of the first plus the square root of the second. And if this is a negative, right, if this was a minus 24, then we wind up with 3x minus 4 and 3x minus 4. But the way I've always felt about that is I can factor it like I always have. It doesn't look special when I look at it, unless I take a while to consider all the possibilities. But just factor it. At the end, I'll say, oh, look, they're the same. Oh, that was one of those special ones. But it just doesn't really, it's not really worth the time to memorize all that. Decide for yourselves. If you want to commit that pattern to memory, that's fine. But it does not jump out to you like this one that jumps out to you. There's only two terms there. They're separated by subtraction. They're both square numbers. It's pretty eye-catching. Whereas this is not really eye-catching. So take that for what it's worth.